Yeah. Don't you love our choir? I just appreciate our choir so much. I always appreciate them letting me sing with them, and then I usually don't have a voice after I get through with that. So y'all might be glad about that. I don't know, but takes them a while to get out of this choir loft. I notice that every week, but it's okay. You know, they do such a great job. Thank you so much, Nancy, and beautiful music this morning. We're so glad that you guys are here. I know that I see a lot of faces visiting with us today, and always want you to know that. If you're visiting with us, we feel like you're a part of us. When you walk in those doors, we want you to feel at home and comfortable with us. And boy, we've got tons of Okie friends here today. Just that whole row across there and those back there. And so we're glad to have them with us. And I was telling my friend Wesley, who's a big Longhorn, that anytime OU beats Texas, you can be sure the Okies will come out of the woodwork. Right? So there they are. No, that's not true. They're not that kind of friends. But they did promise they wouldn't say anything about it. So, you know, that's okay. So we're glad they're here. We're glad that you're here this morning. I want to lead us in a word of prayer this morning before we open God's word together. We are finishing up this morning a wonderful series that we've been in called Renewed Faith. And I'll get us back into it here in just a moment. But I've enjoyed the last few weeks just pouring into Scripture and what it says about faith. And this morning, we're going to close out with a great story of faith that'll be familiar to you. So join me forward in prayer, if you would, before we get started this morning. So pray with me. Father, we are so thankful to you for this day and for this opportunity for us to gather together on this beautiful Sunday. God, we thank you for the beautiful fall weather we're having. We thank you for the sunshine. God, mostly we just thank you for an opportunity to gather and worship you. Father, whether we're worshiping here in person or whether we're gathering on a live stream somewhere, I just thank you for an opportunity that we have to come together to exalt your name this morning. God, to be reminded even through those songs that we've been singing of who you are, God, in worship, but God, also of what you do in our life. God, this morning we just acknowledge before you that you are worthy, worthy, worthy of all honor and glory and praise, and we exalt and lift up your name. And God, I just think that's so important that we do that, God, because your word says that you inhabit those praises. God, that you inhabit the praises of your people. And it just reminds me that you're here this morning in this place. God, we humble ourselves before you. God, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, God, that you want to do a work in this place today. God, you want to touch and change some hearts and some lives right here in this place today. God, there's some people, Father, who are struggling right now, who are down and discouraged. And God, you want to lift some heads and lift some hearts this morning. God, I just believe you want to encourage some folks this morning. God, I believe there's some people in this room this morning that are hurting. And you are God who heals hurts. I just believe that you want to heal those hurts this morning in this place. And you are a God of salvation. God, there may be some in this place or listening to this message this morning that don't know you in a personal way as Lord and Savior of their life. And God, you want more than anything else for them to come to you and for you to pour into their life your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness and cleansing. God, you want to pour into their life salvation. So Father, right now, Father, just with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, we just invite you. We invite you in. We invite you to fall on this place. To have your way. Now, God, soften our hearts. God, help us to not be thinking about what we're going to do later this afternoon or what we have planned for later today. But God, help us just to give this time to you this morning. You are worthy, worthy, worthy of that. And I pray, Lord, that when we get ready to leave this place, Lord, we would leave here, Father, different than we came in because we encountered the living God in your word. And up close and personal. May we be changed this morning through your word, God, and through you. And we'll give you the glory and the praise for what you do today in this place. It's in your name I ask these things. Amen. Amen. You know, perhaps one of the most famous Benjamin Franklin quotes of all time was a simple statement where he said this. He said, "Beware of little expenses. A small leak can sink a great ship." Now, that's a pretty interesting quote, and I love the quote, and I want to kind of change it just a bit. I don't want to talk about finances this morning. That's not what we've been talking about for the past few weeks, and you might be glad that I'm not going to. If you've been around much, you know that's not really kind of my mode to get up here and preach about finances. I don't want to talk about that. We've been talking about faith, and I want to talk about faith, so I want to change Benjamin Franklin's quote just a little bit and kind of personalize it for where we've been and what we've been studying, because I think it still rings true. And I want you to think about it in this regard, in regard to our faith. So let me kind of edit the quote a bit and change it how I might change it to fit for what we're saying. Now, you just mark this down, because this is what we've been talking about the past several weeks. So here's how I might change Benjamin Franklin's quote a little bit. Beware of the little leaks in your faith. Okay? Beware of the little leaks in your faith. A small leak can sink a great ship of faith. And I believe that's true. And when I got to thinking about it, I think, you know, there's example after example in Scripture of just how true that really is. And some of us, as we've been talking over the past few weeks, feel like, you know, over the past year or so, our faith has kind of taken a hit with everything that's going on. And I want you to know that when your faith takes a hit, it affects us spiritually. And even a small leak to your faith can sink a great faith. Think, for example, of Abraham for a minute. Now, we know that Abraham was a man of great faith. As a matter of fact, he's even called the father of all faith, right? He was kind of the man of faith who operated by faith in his life. But think about him for just a little bit. As this father of faith, a little leak in his faith, because he feared for his life, caused him to almost have this great crisis of faith, and it nearly sunk his faith when he lied about who Sarah really was, all because he was just afraid for his life. That's Abraham, the father of all faith. So a little leak in your faith can sink a great ship of faith. Or think about Moses for a second. Boy, Moses is one of our heroes, isn't it? Moses and the great faith that he had. So great was his faith in this God of the burning bush, right? That he led an entire nation of Israel out of the bondage of slavery in Egypt, and even parted the Red Seas and allowed all of God's people to walk through on dry ground. We would say, what a great example of faith. And yet a little leak in his faith caused him to strike a rock instead of trusting God. And because of that little leak in his faith, Moses didn't get to go into the promised land. A little leak in the faith can sink a great faith. Or think about Elijah. Great men of faith, right? I mean, you read about Elijah's life, and it's miracle after miracle. His faith in God was so strong, and so big was his faith that at one time, remember this example, Elijah called down fire from heaven and destroyed 450 prophets of Baal just like that, all by faith. What a great man of faith. And yet a little leak in his faith caused him to run from his life from the wicked Queen Jezebel, and he even prayed to God to kill him, right? Now, just think about that. I don't know what that says to you, but I think it kind of proves that when I changed that quote a little bit ago, it's true, isn't it? A little leak to your faith can sink a great ship of faith. And that's why in the past few weeks, we've been talking about this renewed faith that we've been praying for and asking God to give us. And that's where we've been for about the last 6 weeks, just talking about and asking God to renew our faith, to kind of draw us back to that. Now, just to give you a little bit of a background, kind of some review of where we've been. If you'll remember, several weeks ago, I shared with you a quote from Pew Research that pretty much stated the crisis of faith that we find ourselves in today. If you remember, Pew and all of their surveys of the American public in the last year and a half have found this, and this is kind of their summary statement of their studies, and here's what they said. They said, faith in society's central institutions is the glue that holds society together. That glue was visibly dissolving a decade ago and has now, for many millions of Americans, disappeared altogether. We've lost faith in things, right? And that's what we've been talking about over the past 6 weeks or so. We've been talking about how we've lost faith in so many things around us. Now, they're saying that today Americans have lost faith in some of society's most basic institutions, and that would include the institution of the church. That would include the institution of religion. Our faith, it seems, has a leak today. Maybe that's you. Maybe you have felt that, or maybe there's some things that you've lost some faith in. One of the things we said early in this study is that losing faith in some things today probably isn't a bad thing. It probably is just a reminder that we've had faith in some things we shouldn't have had our faith in, right? So losing faith in some things maybe, but like we've been saying, listen, a lot of people today have lost faith in the government, right? Or they've lost faith in politics or political parties. Well, your faith never should have been there to start with, right? Or maybe they've lost faith in our court system. We've certainly lost faith in the media in so many ways. Listen, if your faith is in the media, God help you, right? But some people have lost that kind of faith. And we've said that losing faith in all of those can't help but cause us to have a crisis of faith in some ways. It can't help but somehow begin to affect us personally, even spiritually. Y'all know that I quoted from Henry Blackaby's book, Experiencing God, a couple of weeks ago. And he says this, in a crisis of faith, you have to decide what you truly believe about God. In other words, is God big enough to handle the crisis I'm in? Is my God big enough to see me through the challenges and the struggles and the difficulties that I'm facing? How big really is my God? Is the God that I claim to believe in really who I claim to believe? Is he doing all that he promised he would do? Or has somehow my faith in my God sprung a leak and my faith is sinking? And I think a good place for us to land today in talking about a renewed faith is to not only pray, God, give me a renewed faith, but when you do, give me one that's unsinkable, right? Give me one that doesn't leak out. Give me a faith that can sustain me, that can hold me up no matter what I'm going through in this life. And I think a good place for us to land is to talk about a man who had an unsinkable faith. A man who seemed to have this unsinkable faith and what we can learn for that. So this morning in our journey in the faith, as we kind of continue on this journey, kind of wrap up this series that we've been in for the past several weeks, we're going to head back to the Great Hall of Fame of Faith. So we're going to be in Hebrews chapter 11. So if you've got your Bible there, mark that. But don't mark it too big, okay? Because we're only going to look at one verse there, Hebrews 11:7. And then we're going to track backwards to the Old Testament and the story that's being talked about in Hebrews 11:7. So we're going to be in Genesis chapter 6 and Hebrews 11:7. And so you'll see this kind of as we begin to unpack this and kind of look at it. Okay? So be finding Hebrews chapter 11 kind of to start with and just stick something in there and then go to Genesis chapter 6. Now listen, if ever there was a man of this kind of faith, a great faith, a great ship of faith, right? An unsinkable faith. It had to be Noah. I'm amazed by Noah and the faith that he had. Listen, this morning, I'm really interested in this, but one of our children's Sunday school classes was studying about Noah. So here's what I want you to do. When you leave church this morning, here's what they did this morning, and I love this. They measured the ark out front of the church. All right? So when you walk out of the church this morning, I want you to look this way, and you'll see a cone down there, and you'll notice all the markings on the sidewalk all the way down, and then look this way, and you'll see a cone on that direction, and you'll get an idea of how big the ark really was. So, okay, so listen to me. It's bigger than this room we're sitting in. It's bigger than this building. It's going to go way past here. Yes, ma'am. Yes. Okay. Right. Yeah. So it's even past that cone. So yeah, be sure we get those cones out there this morning so y'all can see it. But you'll see all the markings. They measured, those kids marked it off this morning. So Margaret, thank you. Margaret's Sunday school class is the one that measured the ark for us today. That's where we're going to be talking about this unsinkable faith. And you say, well, was Noah a perfect man? Absolutely not. Read his story and you'll quickly discover that Noah was not a perfect man. Noah was a man just like us. And yet he had this faith that caused him when storms were raging around him, when everything was going to pot, right? When everything was kind of falling apart in this world, Noah was a man of faith. His faith was unsinkable. And I don't want us to miss that this morning as we look at it. Now, he had this kind of faith that wouldn't sing. He was constantly had this faith that pleased God. Now, we've been saying in our study that you will never please God without faith, right? I mean, First Baptist Church of Buda will never please God without faith. And as a believer in your life, you'll never please him personally without faith. And so I think this bolstering of our faith that we've been talking about, this kind of renewed faith that we're praying about right now, I think it couldn't be a more important topic for us. Listen, we've talked about God restoring our joy in the past year. We've talked about finding peace. We've talked about finding hope. But I'm just telling you, you will never please God as a believer without faith. And so how important is it right now for us to talk about this? So I said I was going to read one verse from Hebrews chapter 11, but let me back up from the verse we're going to be in to verse 6 of Hebrews chapter 11, where the writer of Hebrews simply says this, that without faith, it's impossible to please God. You get that? So you and I will never please him apart from faith. We've got to have faith. And this God-pleasing faith is not just blind optimism, okay? I don't think that when Noah built the ark, he was just being optimistic that God was going to do what he said he would do. No, I think he built that ark by faith. People don't generally build giant boats in the middle of the desert out of blind optimism, right? I mean, there was more than that. And I don't think that it was just believing in spite of the evidence. I think it's far more than that. Rather, God-pleasing faith is obedience to God's word in spite of the circumstances, in spite of the consequences of whatever we might be experiencing. That's what it is. And so I want you to see this. If you're there in Hebrews chapter 11, look at verse 7 there, and it'll kind of start off right there, and then we'll jump to Genesis chapter 6 here in just a moment. But look what it says about Noah. We don't get a lot here in this verse. He doesn't even talk personally about the flood. He alludes to it here, but I want you to see what it says about Noah's faith. Look at Hebrews 11:7, the one verse in the faith chapter I want us to focus on today. And here's what it says about him. It says, by faith, Noah, being divinely warned of things not yet seen, that is, God spoke to Noah, right? That's the divine. He spoke to Noah and he warned him of what was coming. By faith, Noah, being divinely warned of the things not seen, moved with godly fear, awe, reverence, and prepared an ark for the saving of his household, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. Now, sermon's not really based just there, but I want to give you a couple of things there that you need to see about Noah's faith, okay? Now, this is a real faith, a faith that's unsinkable, a faith that says, listen, I want to weather the storms, I want to weather the trials, no matter what's going on around me, I don't want my life to begin to leak, I want a faith that doesn't sink, okay? And this is what, just look at verse 7 there, and notice what these couple of things about Noah's faith. It says he was moved by faith. Now, get that. His faith wasn't just a verbal announcement, oh, I believe in God. You see that? It wasn't just blind optimism. What did it do for him? It moved him, right? It motivated him to act. And I think that is so important for us to understand that in our day, we have so many things that are threatening our faith. Well, listen, our faith ought to motivate us, right? To move out in God's direction, say, God, listen, you're bigger than this. I can trust you in this. Whatever's going on, I'm not going to lose heart. I'm not going to lose joy. I'm not going to lose my peace. I'm not going to lose my hope because my faith is in you and my faith moves me in your direction. You see that? Then it says this, not only did his faith move him, but it says this, he prepared by faith. Do you see that in that verse? He prepared. He got himself ready. He did what he could to do prepared for whatever came in his life, whatever came. Now listen, you say, well, I see Noah, when he prepared, he built an ark. What am I supposed to do? You're supposed to build a life. You're supposed to build a life on the rock that can stand the test of time. How do you do it? How do I prepare not knowing what's ahead, not knowing what tomorrow holds? Listen, we look at the things we've gone through in the last year, year and a half, and we go, well, it can't get much worse. Oh, hold on. Don't ever say that, right? I'm telling you, I don't know what tomorrow holds, and you don't either. We don't know. But I'm telling you, by faith, You can allow your faith to move you in God's direction, and you can be prepared for what's ahead. You know how? First of all, through a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ, you can be prepared. Second of all, by growing in that relationship, spending time in His Word, getting to know the God of Scripture who will give you what you need to stand strong in the struggles and the trials of this life. He can give you what you need, right? You can prepare for that. And you can prepare by worshiping Him, by spending time with Him in prayer. I mean, just think about all the tools He has placed before us, not necessarily to build a boat, an ark, but to build a life that can be prepared whatever comes in our life. So look at this. Here's what we see of Noah in verse 7 about this unsinkable faith. It moved him by faith. He prepared. And look at this. In the very last part there, it says he became. By faith, he became this man of God that God was calling to be, that had an unsinkable faith. And can I tell you that Noah built a big old wooden boat? We're going to talk about that boat here in just a minute. He built a big old wooden boat. And it was unsinkable. They said the same thing about the Titanic, right? Man built the Titanic, right? And it sunk on its maiden voyage. But God built through Noah an unsinkable boat. And I'm just going to tell you, that represents an unsinkable faith to me. You and I can have, we can experience an unsinkable faith. I can't even pretend like I understand all the cuts at your faith that you personally have experienced. I know a lot of us have gone through some common things, right, in the past year, year and a half. But some on a personal level have experienced things even beyond that, personally. I cannot even pretend to understand all the ways your faith has taken a hit. But I can tell you that He wants to give you a renewed faith today that is unsinkable in the future. He can do that. He can give that to you. And I just believe that that's true. Now, jump from Hebrews chapter 7 and jump all the way up, if you would, to this very familiar story that I know you're going to love. It's very familiar. We've read it many, many times. And I'm going to read a lengthy passage of Scripture here with you. And the reason I'm going to read it is because sometimes this particular story gets fairy-tale-ized. I think that's a buddy phrase, but okay. We kind of turn it into this kind of fanciful children's story, right? That we like to decorate children's nurseries with, right? And it gets told and retold. It gets put into children's books and all these kind of things. I mean, Hollywood's even made movies that couldn't be more unbiblical about this story. So I think it's important for us to read what Scripture says about it. I want you to understand what happened. So we're going to be in Genesis chapter 6. I'm going to read verses 5 through 22 so you hear the real account, right? And listen, when God's word goes out, nothing is void, right? Nothing returns void. It'll accomplish its purposes. So you just let the Holy Spirit, through God's word, speak to you about this, because we're going to talk today about this unshakable faith, and I want you to see this. So look with me, if you would, Genesis chapter 6, if you're there, beginning in verse 5. Hey, this will be on the screen too, if it's easier for you to look up here, and it's from the same translation I'm reading from this morning. So if you would rather do that, you do that. So Genesis chapter 6, beginning in verse 5, here's what happened. Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. So the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, creeping things, birds of the air, for I am sorry that I have made man. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And this is the genealogy of Noah. Noah was a just man, perfect in his generation. Noah walked with God. And Noah begot three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. The earth was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence. So God looked upon the earth, and indeed it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. And God said to Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them, and behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Make yourselves an ark of gopher wood. Make rooms in the ark, and cover it inside and outside with pitch. And this is how you shall make it. The length of the ark shall be 300 cubits, its width 50 cubits, and its height 30 cubits. You shall make a window for the ark, and you shall finish it to a cubit from above, and set a door in the ark in its side, and you shall make it with lower, second, and third decks. And behold, I myself am bringing floodwaters on the earth to destroy from under the heavens all flesh, in which the breath of life, everything that is on the earth shall die. But I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall go into the ark, you and your sons, your wife, your sons' wives with you. And of every living thing of all flesh, you shall bring two of every sort into the ark to keep them alive with you. They shall be male and female, of the birds after their kind, of animals after their kind, and of every creeping thing of the earth after its kind. Two of every kind will come to you to keep them alive. And you shall take for yourselves of all food that is eaten, and you shall gather it to yourselves, and it shall be food for you and for them. Thus Noah did, according to all that God had commanded him, so he did. Now, I think we could just stop there and we could cut this sermon short and we could just say, listen, you read verse 22 and you want to know how to build an unshakable verse, then you just practice verse 22, right? You just begin to practice what he did there. It says this, Noah did according to all that God asked him to do. You have that kind of relationship with God where you just trust him. Listen, there's some things that God is asking Noah to do in this passage that had to cause him to go, I don't know, God. Like, I'm a little apprehensive about this, right? Like, I don't know. But we don't see that in Noah in this passage. We see him having this kind of unsinkable faith that said, God, listen, I may not understand it. I may not get it all, but my faith in you moves me to act. It moves me to prepare, and it will help me to become who you've called me to be. You just begin to believe those things like Hebrews 11:7 says. And I'm just telling you, you will begin to build this kind of faith that is amazing. Now, this story is so fascinating to me. I love in verses 14 through 16 that it kind of shows us God's specific instructions to Noah at how to build this ark. It's almost like he gave him the blueprints. Verse 17, he says this, make yourself an ark. And God instructs Noah concerning the materials and the measurements of the ark. And some people get caught up in that kind of stuff. So let me just throw you some kind of interesting tidbits out there about this ark that might help you a little bit. For example, you want to maybe go, well, what in the world is gopher wood? I've never in my life heard of a gopher tree, right? What in the world's a gopher tree? I guess it's the kind that gophers don't cut down, right? Or don't chew up before they get grown. That's not what that is. So there's different ideas there about what that word is, gopher tree. Make it of gopher wood. What is that? Well, in my translation and in many translations, that word gopher wood is one word in the Hebrew. And it's kind of interesting. Some translators will say, well, it was built out of cypress, that it was a cypress tree. And they do that because the Hebrew word for cypress and the Hebrew word for gopher sound very much alike. So a lot of people say, well, maybe it was cypress wood. But I think there's a better explanation. There's a more likely understanding of it. And the word gopher sounds very similar to the Hebrew word kophar, which means pitch, which was a type of material that they added to wood in that day to fishermen's boats that made it buoyant so that it wouldn't sink. And so what most believe that God was instructing Noah to do was to get wood and pitch it so that it will not sink. All right? And I love that. What it tells me is that God tells us to build our life in such a way that it will not sink. And God would not tell you to build your life in a way that will not sink if it wasn't possible. He gives us everything we need, right? To pitch our life in his camp so that it's not sinkable. And I think that's a powerful truth for us to understand. Listen, we don't have to kind of sway with the wind and the waves and take on water when the world around us is kind of sinking and storming and flooding and the waves are blowing when we're going through challenges. And we don't have to be pitched about by that. Our life can be pitched in him so that it is buoyant, so that it floats. So that's kind of interesting. And I don't want to over-spiritualize that, but I think there's a message there for us. That you and I need to pitch our lives into God's camp so that it will float and not sink in the storms of life. You get that? All right. And then he gives us this idea about measurements. And I think this is fascinating. And I was fascinated by the fact that Margaret's class this morning was measuring this out. So the measurements of the ark were 300 cubits long. That's about 450 feet. Okay. She was measuring in yards. And I'm saying that's about 450 feet. It was 50 cubits wide. That's about 70 feet. And it was 30 cubits high. That's about a little bit bigger than a three-story building, okay? So you take this building and you put three of those on top of each other, and it was bigger than that, upwards, okay? So we're talking about a pretty big structure here that God is telling him to build. That means that if you kind of put that in kind of a way that you and I can visualize it, it means that the ark was taller than a three-story building, and its total deck area was the equivalent to about 20 standard college basketball courts. You get that? That's pretty big. I would say you and I would be awed by the size of this. As a matter of fact, they've built an ark, many of you know, in Kentucky, and I think some of you maybe have even been there and seen it. That's supposed to be pretty close to a replica of this, and you can see how humongous this structure really was. Now, there are several features of the ark that are mentioned in our passage of Scripture. In verse 14, it tells us that there were separate rooms. I would hope so, that they kept those animals apart a little bit, right? And so there were rooms in the ark. Verse 16 tells us that there were three stories or decks to the ark. And verse 16 also tells us that there was one door and one window in the ark. Listen, not a place for a person who's claustrophobic, right? I mean, one door and one window, and that's pretty amazing. And the purpose of the ark was to provide a place of shelter, safety, and security for Noah and his family. Very simply stated, right? I mean, if we get nothing else, we get that. And can I just tell you, that's what your faith does for you too. I mean, you and I are to build this kind of life in God and our relationship with Him through Jesus Christ, where we find safety, sheltered in the arms of Jesus, right? And we find security, whatever life is handing us, we find that in Him by faith. Now, I want to kind of focus on this for just a little bit today, and I want you to think about it. We're going to kind of walk all around the ark today, and I loved what I saw happening outside today, because those kids, they had the measurements. They're walking around. And that's what I want us to do, Margaret, here this morning. But I want you to do it with me. I want us to walk all around the ark. I want us to go inside the ark for a minute this morning. And I want us to look out at what we see from inside the ark. I want you to do that with me. And we're going to do that. Okay, that's going to be point number one. Then I want us to go on the outside of the ark. And I want us to look in on what's going on the inside of the ark while all the storms are going on. I want us to see that. And then at the very last thing I want us to do is I want us to stay inside that ark again, and I want us to just look up in that ark. We're going to take an upward look. So we're going to look out from the ark, into the ark, and then up in the ark. And those are kind of going to be our points this morning, and I don't want you to miss that. So let me just give this to you. We're talking about a renewed faith and building a faith that will not sink. And I think each one of these things that God is kind of showing us in this passage is really, really important for us. And I know, guys, I don't have a lot of time left, so we got to move through. This is good stuff, and I don't want you to miss it. So just jot this down somewhere. Here's the first thing I want you to see. First of all, I want us to look out from the ark, and as we do, as we look out from the ark, we're looking out, and it'll cause our faith to sink. Looking out from the ark is enough to cause your faith to sink. Okay? Is that not true? Think about that even today. Looking out past our faith, looking out of the church windows, looking out at our world, looking at what's going on around us, what effect does that have on your faith? Hey, that's what we've been talking about for the last 6 weeks, right? It causes your faith to take a hit. Looking out will cause your faith to sink. So when we go inside there, when we look out, we see the rains falling. We see the waters rising. We see the waves overcoming us. We see the storm. And this storm that Noah faced, it reminds us that often we face storms in our own life. It's just a reminder that, listen, it's a reality. I say this so many times, and I've said it during the study. You are either in a storm, you just came out of one, or you're headed into one. That's what life is like. And when you look out, you're going to see the storms. They're there. In the very next chapter, in Genesis chapter 7, it's where the details of all this flood is going on. And in verses 17 through 20 of chapter 7, you read this. It says this, "Now the flood was on the earth for 40 days. The waters increased, and they lifted up the ark, and it rose high above the earth. The waters prevailed, and they greatly increased on the earth, and the ark moved about on the surface of the waters, and the waters prevailed exceedingly on the earth, and all the high hills under the whole heavens were covered. The waters prevailed 15 cubits upward, and the mountains were covered." So you get what Scripture is telling us in chapter 7 about this storm. It's telling us, listen, when you read verses 17 through 20, you realize this storm was fierce. And I want you to think about what we've been looking at, what we've been seeing in the last year, year and a half, in the last months, even as the church and as Christians, when we look out, what do we see? I think we see a lot of the same things. I mean, when we look out from the ark, we see how extended storms can be, right? Like when they looked out from the ark, it looked must have looked like, will this storm ever end? Will it ever stop raining? I mean, when it rains, it pours. When it pours, it floods, right? And so is this ever going to stop? Will those waves ever calm down? Will the storms ever quit blowing? And you tell me you haven't felt like that at some point in the last 12 months. Is this ever going to be over? Are we ever going to feel the end? So sometimes when we look out, we just go, and you know what that does to us? Not only does that sink our faith, it sinks our hope, right? We start to think, is there any hope? Because we're looking out, and we see it happening, and it's extended, and it's not ending. And then I think also when we look out, we see how extensive the storms are. That passage we read in Genesis chapter 7, verses 17 through 20, said that the waters prevailed, and then it says they increased greatly, and then it says the waters prevailed, and then it said they prevailed exceedingly. Do you see what they're seeing when they look out? They're seeing how extensive this storm is. It's affecting everything. It's affecting everybody, right? And that's how we felt. Nobody is untouched by this storm, and it was expansive. The waters covered the earth. They were there for right? It flooded on the earth for 40 days, and then it was exhausting because it continued. The fountains of the earth broke up, the waters rose, and the heavens were opened, and the severity of it, when you look out, is enough to sink your faith. And that's where some of us have been. We're still looking out. We're still watching out there. Instead of being like Moses, I mean like Noah in chapter 7 of Hebrew, where listen, he was moved by his faith. He prepared by his faith. He became by his faith. I'm going to tell you something. Listen, we're going to see this here in just a second. He got his eyes off of the storm. There was a point when he quit looking out because looking out did nothing but discourage his faith. And he said, listen, God's made some promise to me. I'm going to keep my eyes on that. I'm going to continue to focus on him. So that's number one. So get that down somewhere. Listen, looking out can sink your faith. Now, here's the second one. You ready? I know my time's going, so I'm moving quick, guys. All right. Here's number two. Look at this. Second, when we look inside, if we're outside now and we look inside the ark, I'm going to tell you that will settle your faith. So we've changed directions now. We're not looking out at the storm anymore. Now we're on the outside of the ark and we're looking in. And I want you to think about this. Looking into the ark will settle your faith. Now watch this. This is our first look. We went inside the ark and we looked out and we saw nothing but the storms. But in our second look, I want you to look inside that ark. And when you look in and you look into that ark from the outside, listen, you may think when you looked in, you saw chaos, right? I mean, there's all kinds of animals in there that don't like each other. It's smelly. It's stinky. There's lots of life going on in there. Listen, when you look in there, you see life. Life continues. Life goes on. That ark represented life goes on. God's in control. He has provided. And listen, life goes on in the ark. Are you aware of how much our discouragement and despair and all the heaviness that we feel, how much of that comes from looking at the storm instead of looking at the Savior? Are you aware of how much of our depressions and discouragement, the heaviness comes from looking out of the ark instead of looking into the ark? And I want you to see this because I think this is so powerful when you kind of start to dig apart from this. But I want to tell you, when you look into that ark, you see his preservation, right? You see that he preserves us And I think that's so important. Now think about this. Noah and his family were not spared from going through the storm. You get that? That they were not spared from going through the storm, but they were kept in the storm. You see that? He preserved them in that storm. And I think that's very, very, very powerful. Now, in Genesis 6, verse 14, it says, here's that word again, they were to cover it with pitch. And I've already talked a little bit about pitch. That word literally means to coat or cover, that Hebrew word translated there as pitch. It means to coat something or to cover something. And I want you to understand something, that if you're a believer in Jesus Christ and you have placed your faith in him, listen, you can be moved by that faith. You can prepare by that faith, because what has he done? And we said, listen, we need to pitch ourselves into the arms of Jesus. But here's what he does. He covers us, right? He covers us. I think it's kind of interesting when you think about, even in the New Testament, when Jesus kind of calmed the storm. And remember that story? He said, let's get in the boat and go to the other side. Remember that? And then in the midst of going to the other side, the storm rose up. They encountered a storm. Now I thought about this just a little bit. You know, if you think about that, Jesus never promised when they got in the boat there wasn't going to be a storm. He just promised them they were going to get to the other side. Have you ever thought about that? And listen to me, Christian, he's made the same promise to you, right? Get in the boat with him and he'll get you to the other side. Now, between here and the other side, there might be some challenges, but I've given you the faith that you need to sustain you in that. And I think that's a powerful thing when you think about that. Now, I want you to see this, because we're still looking inside the ark and we're seeing the chaos, right? We're seeing life's happening in that ark, right? There's all kinds of animals. There's all kinds of life. But that's not what I primarily want you to see inside the ark. What I really want you to see inside the ark is his presence. And I've never paid attention to this before when I've read this story, but I want you to see this. Look at Genesis 7, verse 1, if you're there. This wasn't a part of the lengthy passage I read, but now we're going into the ark, and I want you to see this. Then the Lord said to Noah, come into the ark, you and all your household, because I have seen that you are righteous before me in this generation. Now, I've never thought about this before, but I thought about it different this time. And I want you to see this is why when you look in the ark, you're going to see something special here. Now look what he says there very carefully. The Lord said to them, come into the ark. Notice he didn't say, go into the ark. It's as if God is inside the ark, inviting them to come in and join him. Do you see that? I've never noticed that before. And I'm like, well, where's God in this? He's inside the ark, and he said, come on in. Come on in with me. That's the same invitation he gives to us, right? In the midst of the storms and the trials and the difficulties. Here's what he says to us. Come on in. Come in with me. When you look from the outside looking in into the ark, you know what you see? Yeah, you see a lot of chaos, but guess who's in the ark? Noah's family? Yeah, you got that right. Two of every kind of animal? Yeah. That's not what I want you to see. God is in the ark. He's in there. You want a faith that doesn't sink? It's found in him. It's found in his presence. That's where you get there. Now, I've got to give you this last one, because time's going to slip away, and I don't want you to miss this one, because we've looked from the inside out, right? And we've seen the storm, and it's scary, and we've been through the storms, and they're scary, and we're wondering if we're going to survive them. Now we've gone outside the ark, and we've looked in, and we've gone, you know, inside the ark, God's presence is there. And then I want you to see this last look, okay? So there's this one final look that I want you to take. Thirdly, I want you to look up, and I want you to see how looking up can strengthen your faith. In other words, it can give you an unsinkable faith when you look up in the midst of the ark. And I think this is pretty interesting, really, because in verse 16, it tells us this. You shall make a window for the ark. You shall finish it to a cubit from inside. Now, here's what happened when you read the story. God put a door in the side and a window in the top, okay? And when they went in, it says God sealed that door up. There's no getting out of that door until God says it's time to get out of that door, right? But the window at the top was there. And the only way they could see out of that ark was to look up. And I want you to think about that, because this is very interesting. When you kind of start studying it, you kind of start looking in it. Now look at verse 16, because it tells us how big this window is. It says that it was finished to a cubit from above, okay? So it was only a cubit. You know how big a cubit is? 18 inches. All right? So that's the tip of your pointing finger to the tip of your elbow. That's about 18 inches. That's how big this window was. It was a square window at the very top of this higher than three-story building. That's all they got, right? Now, let me just tell you, I don't want to over-spiritualize the story, but let me just tell you something that I read this week. I was studying this passage, and I was looking this up in some commentaries, and A.W. Pink, great theologian, he said this, and I never thought about this before, but he said this: Noah and his companions were not to be looking down on the scene of destruction beneath and around them. They were to be looking up towards the living God through that window. You get it? They weren't to be looking out at the storms that would discourage them. Where would they be looking? The only place they could, up. And it's very interesting to me because, listen, why was the window so small? Because it focused their attention. You get it? It was so small that their focus had to be on only one thing, and that was on God and His provision for them, right? They had to trust Him in the midst of it. Now, you want a faith that will not sink? That's the picture you get. You and I can look out and focus on the storms, and I'm going to tell you that will sink your faith. And remember that a little leak in your faith can sink a great faith, right? Right? You want to look out, your faith's going to sink. And today, some of us have been there. We've been talking about it for the past few weeks. We're praying for a renewed faith, but I want to take it a step further today. Lord, don't only renew my faith, make it unsinkable, right? But then if you get outside that boat and you look in, you realize there's Noah and his family, and there's all kinds of chaos going on in there with all those animals, but mostly inside of that place is God's presence. He's there, right? And then you want to know, well, how do, in the midst of all of that, how do I, well, you look up. You look up through the only window He's giving. You quit looking at all those other things around you, and you turn your eyes on Him. I quoted this song last week. I'm going to close with it today because it's beautiful. Remember that great song of faith, right? Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. All right, we got through it, guys. Bow with me forward a prayer. With heads bowed and eyes closed, our talented, talented ladies are going to come and just begin to play our invitation song to the glory of God. We're going to talk about glorifying His name. Just glorifying His name. I think after a message like this, after reading about what He wants to do in our life, all we can do is worship Him, right? Glorify Your name. So here's what I want us to do. I'm going to lead us in a prayer, and then we're just going to open up this time of response to Him. You can stand there and worship Him, right, for who He is, even in the midst of the storms and the trials and the hits to our faith that we've taken, because God is a sustaining God, and He will not let you sink. You can just worship Him in that. Or maybe you're here today and you go, listen, I'm struggling through this thing. I want that kind of faith that won't sink. I want that. Now, if you're here today and that's you, listen, you cry out to Him today and say, God, give me a renewed faith and an unsinkable one. Help me right now to fix my eyes on You and You alone, and not on the storm and not on what's going on around me, but just to focus on You. And God, would You bolster my faith? I want to pitch my life into Your camp. If you've never trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, listen, that's the starting place. Right where you sit today. Place your life in His hands. And if you're a believer in this room and you've done that, but you've taken some of it back, you begin to get your eyes out looking at the world, and maybe you've gotten caught up in some of the things, and it's time for you to come home to Him, get back in the ark with Him, focus on Him. I don't know all the way. I know how God has used this message in my life this week, how He's changed my focus, how I've struggled and wrestled with this myself through the week. It's been tough. I know what He's saying in my heart. All I can do is adjust my life to that. Listen, you're responsible for how you adjust your life to what He's saying. So in this response time, I would just ask you to hear His voice and respond to Him as He leads, whatever that is. Father, we thank You for the truth of Your word. Thank You for this time that we've had to worship You in it today. And God, I just believe that You are speaking through this beautiful story of Noah's Ark. And God, I believe You want to strengthen our faith through that. God, You want us to have this faith that is unsinkable, because so many in the world are hurting and they want to know, does faith work? It absolutely works. It absolutely works. Help us to be a model of that. God, I pray for those who may need to respond to that. You give them courage to step out and come by faith to respond to you. And Lord, we will give you and you alone all the praise and the honor and the glory, what you do in this place. We love you, we praise you, and we commit this time of response to you. It's in your name I ask these things. Amen. Would you stand with us as we sing our closing hymn of worship before him? And if God's spoken to your heart and you need to come as we sing. This is just your time to respond to what he's saying in your heart.